Welcome, and I want to thank all the branches that are hosting video sites across Texas. As the State Association for Civil Engineers, we're happy to provide this service to the engineering community. If you don't happen to be a member of ASCE or the Texas section, I invite you to become a member so that you can benefit from being a part of this professional association. Now let me give an introduction of our presenter for this afternoon's training, Mark Farrell, PE. Mark has served as a geotechnical engineering consultant in Dallas-Fort Worth Metroplex since 1975 and has performed thousands of geotechnical investigations across the state. His technical expertise includes project management, consulting on structural failures, investigation of landslides, and testifying as an expert witness in geotechnical related matters. Typical project involvement included treatment plants, deep pump stations, tollways and highways, roadways, bridges, drainage structures, airport facilities, high, mid, and low-rise office buildings, hotels, hospitals, commercial buildings, malls, and industrial projects. Now, let me ask Mike to give us his presentation on the leading causes of litigation over the past decade. Mark?
Okay, thank you. Well, there's no secret. Litigation, construction litigation is constantly on the rise. And we seem to do a lot of consulting regarding forensic investigations and that sometimes lead to litigation. And most of our practice is defending other engineers against frivolous suits. And that's one of the big problems is the frivolous suits that come against various engineers when there's a problem. And most of the time, the problem is because of geotechnical issues. but when there is a problem, everybody involved, the civil engineers, the architects, structural engineers, all the contractors, it's just the old shotgun approach where everybody is shot at and sued, and then you have to defend yourself, and it's very costly, even for defense of a frivolous suit. And a lot of times, the frivolous suits are difficult to get out of because of the nature of litigation in Texas, where all it takes is another engineer to do a certificate of merit, indicating maybe some little nitpicky, insignificant detail of a design is blown up out of proportion, and then in order to keep all various parties involved in the lawsuit. And so it just gets very expensive to defend yourselves against these frivolous suits. This the screen I've got now talks about briefly several of the cases we can talk about today. And I guess I'm going to go into detail on the more detailed description of the problems. Of a lot of these may seem routine nothing out of the usual when you talk some of these cases, but they're very serious and very expensive. Simple problems like pavement settlements over pedestrian tunnels, deep utility trenches, adjacent, pavements over adjacent retaining walls, settlements of 8 to 12 inches can occur when proper construction isn't performed and proper testing isn't performed. Even though it's an obvious construction testing problem, the civil engineers, structural engineers get involved because of the serious problem. And of course, during testing, the most common problem are excessive lift thicknesses. And everybody probably takes for granted that a testing lab is testing properly. But a lot of times, and more often than not, technicians will go out to the site and take a test on a compacted lift with no knowledge of how thick the lift is. They don't know if it's, it specs are for an 8-inch compacted lift, but you know the lift thickness is maybe 2 or 3 feet, and technicians don't catch that because they're not properly identifying elevations of their lifts. And it's very simple to document that when you have a structure such as a pedestrian tunnel. You know, you have a deep utility trench or a retaining wall. It's very easy. What our technicians are instructed to do is to mark the lifts in 8-inch layers along the sidewall of the structure or the trench, and identify lift numbers so that they can keep track of lift thicknesses and proper compaction. And you think that's, you know, something that very simple to do. It is very simple to do, but it's just not done, and it results in problems. The other problem is you've also would suspect that testing labs obtain proper proctors, and a lot of times there may be 20 different proctors on a project, 20 different soil types. Maybe there's rubble in the fill, rock and rubble, and if the proper proctors aren't obtained, obviously, then your results are going to be meaningless. And again, you're going to have settlements of 8 to 12 inches, and it's happened too many times to mention. And another problem, again, you suspect that the technicians are doing the proper matching of proctors. Hate to say it, but a lot of technicians out there take a test and then have to look at their proctor summary and then just match up the results to a proctor that matches the result, which may not at all be accurate. And so as the bottom line is, we just get involved in way too many forensic problems of serious settlements because of poor construction tests, poor construction and poor construction testing. And of course the contractor is certainly not blameless. They know what they're doing. They know when they're putting in lifts that are too thick. But the problem is, you know, the technicians have got to be smart enough to catch that and call the contractors, hold their feet to the fire, and not allow these types of problems. Because when it does happen, it's very costly to the owner, for the engineers, for everybody involved, and then it's certainly a liability for the testing lab. Okay. Here's one. Hydrostatic blowouts below deep excavations for tanks and below grade structures underlain by water bearing soil and deep aquifers. When we're doing a geotech investigation, a lot of times the client will, if he has a 30-foot deep structure, he may say, I need borings, I need 30-foot borings. Of course, we advise the client that 30-foot, we've got to get well below the structural depth of the trenches or the below grade structure. And whether it be a tank or a below grade pump station, any type of below grade structure, you obviously have got to get well below the structure to identify not just the bearing capacity of the soil, but dewatering requirements. The most difficult, the trickiest conditions are when you're in mapped deep alluvial soils. And it's all that available mapping is on geologic mapping. You can have an idea if you're going to be in deep alluvial soils when a geotech investigation is going to be performed. And you know, the structural engineers, the civil engineers, obviously the geotech engineers, all that information is available to allow you to know what type of conditions you're going to have, whether it's going to be just a typical geologic formation, or if you're going to be in deep alluvial deposits, whether it be shallow or terrace deposits, or very deep alluvial soils due to previous river deep creek erosion. Now, the thing is, when you're in the deep alluvial soils where shale depths might be, you know, 65, 70 feet, a lot of times the soils, you might have clay soils to 40 feet depths. And you say you have a structure at 25 feet and you do a boring to 40 feet, but you may not even get into groundwater because the deep aquifer soils are overlain by those clay soils. And unless you penetrate those aquifer soils, you're not gonna even find where the actual groundwater level is. And so the problem is, and this has happened again a number of times, is, you know, excavation may go to 20 feet depths in these conditions. For example, say the groundwater level, the piezometric level, say it's 10 feet deep, and you're at a 20 foot depth of excavation, you won't see any groundwater immediately because the aquifer soils are very deep. It takes quite a bit of time for water to percolate upward through the clay soils. But after a period of time, you're going to, you know, some water is going to be observed. And a lot of times it's chalked off to rain or something else where they're not really suspecting it's groundwater since it didn't flow in immediately. And, you know, over time it just gets worse. And then the contractor tries to pump it out and excavate the soft soil. And of course, the deeper you excavate, the more water you get into, because now you're getting closer to the aquifer soils. And after a period of time, after a lot of construction delays, finally they figure out, gee, we must really have a groundwater problem. And then they call out a groundwater expert. And a lot of times you think that these groundwater experts are going to do the correct program for dewatering, but a lot of them will put in well points in clays, and that doesn't do anything. They put in the well points, there's real no improvement, and the cotton, you know, maybe they get rid of the surface water, but that's about it. And then as they excavate and try to improve the subgrade, you know, they have an excavation blowout. And that's the real problem, and that's why the borings have got to be taken deeper, because when you're in a deep alluvial soil condition and you've got to have deep wells, well points won't work in clayey soils when you have an artesian condition, aquifer soil at depth, and you're trying to eliminate a piezometric head that's up in the cohesive clays. And so deep wells are required to dewater these conditions, and of course, that's very expensive, but that's what's needed. And if the proper dewatering method is determined up front, then a lot of cost and time lost can be eliminated. This is a problem here. The bailed pier foundation upheaval below structurally suspended slabs due to soil swell uplift. Now, I've been using bailed piers since 1975. They were used way before that, obviously. But, you know, bailed piers are very typical when you don't have rock at reasonable depths, or if you have a shallow, a lightly loaded structure and you've got granular soils, and you're going to have to case piers for lightly loaded structures. It's very costly. So obviously we use bailed piers under that condition. Now, geotech engineers and structural engineers are used to typical details. They've done so many projects, they get used to using typical details for bailed piers, typically bailed pier depths 15 to 18 feet, bail to shaft ratios of 2 to 1 minimum for soil swell uplift. That's pretty typical in just about all the geotech reports I read. And that's perfectly fine when you're doing excavation, moisture conditioning, or water injection to pre-swell the expansive clays to reduce the PVR, to swell PVR to 1 inch for slab on grade construction. But the problem is when bailed piers are used for structurally supported slabs, there's no moisture conditioning performed because you're going to be putting the floor slabs on carton farms or a crawl space. And so the piers are installed within very dry, highly expansive soils because of the need for the structural floor. The soils are very expansive. And as a result, the soil swell uplift on the pier shafts is much larger than the typical value used when moisture conditioning is performed. You know, typical values of about 2,000 pounds per square foot along the upper 10 feet of a shaft is a pretty typical recommendation, and which is perfectly fine when you have moisture conditioning to reduce the swell. But when you are using piers for a structural slab and you're installing those piers in highly expansive soils, that soil swell uplift force is a function of the shear strength. And the shear strength is obviously extremely high because the soils are hard and dry. Your shear strength is going to be over 5,000 pounds per square foot. And so your swell uplift is going to be much larger for belt piers in highly expansive soils. Also, the belt to shaft ratio of 2:1 is not going to be adequate. Despite common belief, you know, the uplift resistance is not that inverted cone from the extending upward on an angle to the ground surface where you're mobilizing all the weight of the soil in an inverted cone above the bell. That is not applicable for belled piers supporting building structures. That might be applicable for the ultimate uplift of, for say, a guy wire or something, where uplift movement is not a problem, minor uplift. But when you have a structure, you don't want differential uplift of 2 or 3 inches. And the uplift resistance for belled piers is a function of the bearing capacity directly above the belt. And when you run the numbers, a belt to shaft ratio of 2:1 just does not come close to handling the uplift resistance that's needed. And a paper was performed, I don't know how many years ago, by Dr. O'Neill. He came up with a design methodology for belled piers in expansive soils. And when you run the numbers based on that methodology, if you're installing belled piers in dry, expansive clays, your belled pier depth is needed to be in the range of 30 feet and not 15 feet. And you're going to need the belt to shaft ratio of 3:1, which is the maximum for uplift resistance. So beware, whether it be a geotech engineer or structural engineer, if you're using belled piers for a suspended building, structural floor, and expansive soils, your 15 to 18 foot belled pier depth and 2:1 belt to shaft ratio is not going to be good. There's going to be a problem. Structural engineer is going to get tagged. Ultimately, the geotech engineer will get tagged. Just know that typical belled pier details do not work for structurally supported buildings on expansive soils. And here's another problem. Crush piping below structurally suspended slabs over deep, dry, highly expansive clay. You know, when you're designing a structural floor slab on piers, you got your floor slab and your grade beams and pier caps constructed over void spaces. You protect your structure, but the piping is installed below the slab in the expansive clay. Now, of course, when you do piping below a ground, a slab on grade where you've done moisture conditioning and swell is not an issue, there's no problem with typical piping in the ground. But when you use piping below the structurally suspended slabs and you've got a swell potential of 6 or 8 inches and your slab is protected, but your piping is going to heave and crush because it's rigidly connected to the suspended slabs. And when that heaves and crushes, it is extremely costly to repair because you've got a tunnel underneath the building and to get to the broken pipe. And there's been many litigation cases where it's a $1 million problem to correct the piping below the structurally suspended slabs. And of course, the geotech engineer should really put a warning in the reports about that, that they need to, you know, preferably use a crawl space and to where you can attach the utility lines to the suspended slab over a crawl space. That's the preferable way to do it. Yeah, there's other methods out there that have been developed where, you know, void systems can be provided below the utility lines, and the lines can be suspended to the slab that's over a void space, but that's expensive too. The real preference is when you have an expansive soil condition, you really, the preference highly recommended is to use the crawl space so that you can, first of all, access the crawl space for maintenance, number one. Number two, you can hang your utility lines to the suspended slab. They're protected from excessive movement. And then you can just take a look at your transition when you go from the crawl space to the adjacent expansive soil. Just make sure your details are appropriate to handle large differential movement beyond the crawl space where the expansive soils are going to cause the piping to heave differentially, obviously, than the piping that's suspended to the floor. But this is a big problem. Structural engineers get tagged with it. Mechanical engineers get tagged with it. And it just, I don't know, it just is a problem that's just been ignored for many years. And then it's also very good for geotech engineers to bring this to everybody's attention that this is a big problem, and a crawl space, even though it's more expensive, it's highly recommended because of, you know, the liabilities, $1 million liability to fix this type of problem. High humidity in facilities and excessive moisture and corrosion in crawl spaces. I don't know, we've been involved in at least a dozen cases over the last 10 years, you know, for schools where the architect has been sued, the architect, mechanical engineer, civil engineer, and then structural engineer for not appropriate corrosion protection below the crawl space because of humidity in the crawl spaces below schools. Now, these schools that we've investigated, they all had crawl spaces, and but moisture was not controlled during construction, even though there were details, you know, in the plans, typical details to control drainage during construction, after construction, all the same language, never enforced. You know, the contractor, you know, would not control the water. Water would be ponding in the crawl space. He didn't pump it out. Water would be ponding in the excavations, and it just wasn't strongly enforced. And I mean, you can enforce these requirements by, you know, holding back pay applications, you know, but nothing was done. And and so you have all this water below the facility during construction, and it's on the punch list to fix the problem, and it just never gets fixed properly, and it gets covered up, and everybody forgets about it. And then, you know, all these schools had a requirement for drainage in the crawl space, where the crawl space was graded. Drain inlets were installed below the crawl space to drain any water that came in, and but the grading is never done properly. Nobody checks it. They leave it to the contractor, and he doesn't do it right. He doesn't even come close to grading these things properly. He doesn't control siltation and erosion, and the drain inlets become clogged. And then, you know, to aggravate the problem further, you know, a lot of grading isn't performed correctly. Got flat negative grades next to the building. Water gets in the facility constantly in different paths of water migration. And so you end up with this high humidity, and then that causes all kinds of problems to the molding, you know, humidity in the schools, fungus, mold, you know, corrosion in the crawl spaces. And then, of course, the MEP engineer is blamed for not providing correct ventilation, even though, you know, he provided a suitable system and the architect provided a suitable system. The contractor just didn't build it correctly and it just wasn't inspected and caught. And so my recommendation here is this needs to be added to the inspection list of having this thing, these details closely inspected and enforced, where the contractor truly has to control water conditions during construction, grade the crawl space, pump out the water, grade it properly like he's supposed to, and then keep the crawl space and the excavations dry. And it just needs to be controlled much more closely than it is, because when it's not, it's just a big, huge problem and everybody is sued and it's very costly. Here's another one. Negative drainage and ponding after construction along flat work adjacent to buildings, causing water migration into facilities due to excessive soil swelling. Now, hate to say it, but you know, when geotech engineers, you know, in the report, they include a PVR calculation. And part of the problem, this negative drainage and ponding, it's a twofold problem. Number one, the soil swell PVR is grossly underestimated by most geotech engineers because they're still using that TxDOT 124E method. That's an empirical method that was developed 50 years ago, where instead of running swell, well, the method was actually developed running swell tests. And then the charts were prepared based on PI and moisture content. It's a very easy method to use. That's why geotech engineers use it. You just run PIs and moisture content, and then you go to the charts and you come up with a PVR. The problem is that method, when they developed that method, it was for TxDOT roadways, and the developer made the assumption that only one third of the swell was going to occur upward. And so he ran swell tests and divided his swell result by three when he developed the charts. And that might be okay if you've got a pavement that's well graded, no free water sources. If you don't have free water sources, you're not gonna have swelling. And maybe that, you know, the reason that you did that for the pavements, for TxDOT pavements. But when you've got a building facility and you've got free water sources, you got irrigation, you got, you know, utility leakage, you got sprinkler leakage, water is always going to find that expansive soil, and the swelling is going to be 2 to 3 times larger than the estimate in the geotech reports when that method is used. That's number one. Number two, the civil engineers just seem to ignore the PVR, you know, in areas that are sensitive to movement, where you've got flat work extending to the building, you've got maybe 10, 20 foot wide sidewalks, you know, you got maybe pavements extending to the building. The moisture conditioning, you know, typically only extends 5 feet beyond the building lines because the only attention is given to the swell below the building. And so you may say you have a 6 or 8 inch swell PVR, and you do your excavation, moisture conditioning, water injection, you know, within the building, 5 feet out from the building to reduce the swell to 1 inch. Well, fine, but then 5 feet out from the building, you've got a swell PVR of 6 or 8 inches. And if you aren't considering that, you're going to end up with negative drainage, water migration in the facilities, and that causes a multitude of problems. It causes, you know, water on the floors, results in slippery conditions, people slipping and falling, you know, flat work, prevents doors from operating correctly. You know, you get water into certain facilities and then you can end up with mold and mildew and just a whole array of problems. And then repairing these problems are extremely difficult because when you graded the site and you didn't consider the swell PVR, and then you've got this differential heave, large differential heave and negative drainage adjacent to the building, you just can't take out a narrow section of pavement. You've got to take out extensive pavement to get to a point where it drains again. Because you may have to take out 30, 40 foot of pavement to get to a point that's still going to drain properly. And so, again, it's a big problem, and it's a combination of geotech engineers underestimating the PVR and the civil engineers not considering the PVR. Even the reduced PVR that's in the report isn't considered. If the geotech engineer the geotech engineer should really provide guidance about extending excavation limits beyond building lines based on the site plan and the details of the flat work and pavement around the building. Ought to call that out and recommend expanded limits of moisture conditioning for the facility. But if he doesn't, the civil engineer, architect and civil engineer need to be considering this, because the solution is extending the moisture conditioning limits well beyond the building lines to a point where you can then increase the grades. I know the ADA requirements, you know, keep those grades at 2% near the building, but then if you get to a certain point, you know, you can increase those grades. So it's going to be a combination of extending the moisture conditioning limits to reduce the swell to the point where you can then slope the pavement more radically to accommodate the swell. But this has caused a lot of problems, and the repairs are extremely expensive, you know, when you get into the litigation. And then everybody's tagged, geotech engineer, architect, civil engineer, they're all tagged for the problem. This is one: shrink swell movement of bridge approach slabs and armored slopes around bridges due to soil swelling and consolidation. We do these bridge approach slabs, we have, you know, recommendations for transition slabs. Approach slabs need to be prepared to prevent that abrupt movement at the bridges. And also the armored slopes around bridges. It needs to be, the settlement estimates need to be addressed so that the owner can determine if those settlements are going to be acceptable. And then a lot of the problem is a lot of these design build contracts, the concession who's doing these projects is squeezing everybody to come up with the reduced cost. And, you know, to reduce the excavation, you know, to eliminate anything expensive like cement treated soil or flowable fill, you know, around armored slopes where, you know, to prevent settlements. And so they are squeezing all the consultants to come up with the least expensive method. But then when there's a problem, that same owner, concession owner, then is suing everybody because of the problems with the movements at the bridge approach slabs, the armored slopes. You know, when you get the settlement of those armored slopes, you know, then separations occur, you know, along the top of the armored slope and the abutments, and water gets in those, that backfill. It causes additional consolidation, causes erosion, causes those armored slopes to fail. And then, you know, the geotech engineer, civil engineer are tagged with the problem. And so I guess the main thing here is to get the geotech engineer to document very closely the amount of movement at bridge approach slabs, settlement at bridge approach slabs if you have deep fill, swelling of the bridge approach slabs, settlement of armored slopes. If you have 30 foot deep fill below an armored slope, 30 foot of fill, you know, at even 1% slope is, you know, 4 inches of movement. And so settlement. And if you don't have, and of course that's if you don't get any erosion and and hydro compaction from this water seeping in. But when you get those, you end up with 6 to 8 inches of settlement, if not more. And so the real key here is to really document to the owner the amount of movement that's going to occur, what is necessary to prevent these movements, and the fact that it's going to be a maintenance item, a significant maintenance item if the settlements occur, and the solution would be cement treated soil or blowable fill below these armored slopes, and obviously shrink swell bridge approach slabs would be excavation and moisture conditioning, for a distance for the bridge approach slabs to accommodate the movement and be able to not disrupt operations. Upheaval of floor slabs and piers due to excessive soil swell uplift caused by deep-seated soil swelling. Most geotech engineers look at the soil swell PVR within the upper 10 feet. Last 10 years, a lot of engineers have looked at a deeper active zone, maybe 15 feet, but not consistently. Still, most geotech engineers are looking at the upheaval in the upper 10 feet. Now, at some sites, you've got a deep-seated swell potential that can be very significant below a typical 10-foot depth of treatment. And, whether it be any free water source is going to cause a problem. It can be a groundwater fluctuation, can be leaking utility lines, either outside the building, inside the building. Typically, outside the building is more of a problem because it's not noticed quickly. Inside the building, it's obviously noticed more quickly and fixed. But outside the building, you get utility leakage. It's not identified, causes a deep-seated swell problem, and then causes severe upheaval of floor slabs and piers. Because if you have, your piers are designed for, say you've done 10 foot of excavation and moisture conditioning, and you're using a 10 foot soil swell uplift uplift on the upper 10 foot of the piers. And if you get deep-seated swell, your uplift pressure can actually be double than what it was designed for. And we found this to be a problem at a facility recently where the piers were designed for a 10-foot uplift zone, and groundwater fluctuations caused deep-seated swelling. And the piers heaved, last count, it was 3 or 4 inches. Belled piers heaved. It was a hybrid system where belled piers were used for floor slab support, and straight shafts were used for a perimeter of the building. And the straight shafts around the perimeter were heaving because of inadequate anchorage, because of the excessive uplift force, and I think also due to construction defects. The piers had construction defects in them where they weren't reinforced properly. And it's caused both upheaval of the straight shafts and the belled piers of 3 or 4 inches. And again, the structural engineer didn't do anything wrong. He followed the recommendation of the geotech to the letter, and it just wasn't, that deep sea and swell potential wasn't identified. But nevertheless, the architect, structural engineer, and the geotech engineer, obviously the geotech engineer, they all got tagged for severe problems. And it was a $12 million problem for spread among various parties because of the foundation uplift. The solution was needle piles to replace the existing piers. And that's extremely expensive, requiring tunneling underneath the building and just a variety of costly items. Settlement of deep case piers due to improper case pier installations. When we're doing pier inspection on a project with case piers, you got to watch it very closely. There's all kinds of things that can go wrong with a cased pier installation. The pier drillers, number one, they don't want to stick their casing. They don't want their casings to get stuck. And so when they case their piers, as soon as they start their concrete placement, they're wanting to budge the casings upward to make sure they're not going to get stuck, because it's very costly for them to stick their casings. And so probably every job we're on, piers have to be abandoned and redone because the contractor has pulled his casings too quickly, allowing water and caving soil to get into the pier hole because he didn't have enough concrete head. And if it's probably, like I said, two or three piers on every project we do, it happens. But there's some projects where we do consulting where it obviously wasn't watched very closely because these piers were faulty. And again, it's a construction problem, but it's a combination of contractor, but also the pier inspector. You know, you've got to take a very active role. You got to have a testing lab that's taking a very active role in watching the installation and extraction of these piers and casings. And the testing firms, I just think they just try to minimize their involvement because they think that they're going to have a liability if they're involved too heavily. That's just not our philosophy. You need to have a testing lab that's going to be heavily involved and take charge on these projects and watch them closely. And, you know, when there's a problem, you know, you got to hold the contractor's feet to the fire and call it out. The contractor's going to be very unhappy because he's got to abandon his pier, pull the steel, drill out the concrete, start all over. But that's just what happens. And then once he does that once or twice, you know, he's going to do it correctly in the following piers. But I guess engineers, everybody thinks that these piers are being watched very closely when there's a testing lab on the site. That's not quite the case. It's not watched very closely at all. And bailed piers is particularly another problem. Bailing is not watched very closely by the inspectors. That piers in difficult soils are not bailed properly, or they cave in due to caving soils, or the hard soils are hard to bail, and so they don't ever get their bail dimensions. And if they do, in caving soils, they collapse. This has been another problem on a number of projects where the bailed piers were not constructed to the correct dimensions, and significant differential foundation movement occurred. And again, it's a combination. The contractor didn't do it right. The testing lab didn't check it. And of course, nobody in the contractor side is paying attention to any quality issues. They're just paying attention to schedule and concrete placement. They just want to hurry up and get them poured. And there's nobody paying attention to the quality details if the testing lab is asleep on the job and not doing their job. So owner engineers, you just need to really put in your contracts that these testing labs are paying close attention to these pier details and not just documenting pier depths, concrete placement. They need to document every detail of pier installation very closely. Excessive heave of basement slabs due to soil swelling. A lot of people think, you know, if you got a basement slab, you know, you've got a stable condition below your slab because it's below the depth of seasonal moisture change. You know, I had a lot of clients think, well, gee, I've got a 10, 15 foot basement. It's well below the zone of swelling, so I ought to be okay. Well, you know, sometimes you are, sometimes you're not. Most often you're not okay because this expensive soils, if you've got deep clay soils, if they may not even be highly expansive based on overburden pressure. But when you excavate 15 feet for a basement slab, all of a sudden that soil that might be reasonably stable under overburden is going to have a significant heave because of rebound due to soil swelling. And so that there's been many facilities where the basement heave has been a problem. And of course, everybody gets sued, you know, contractors, structural engineers, architect, you know, everybody can find, you know, people can find little minor nitpicky things that weren't done just right. Maybe it doesn't have anything to do with the problem. The problem is the geotech recommendation was improper. But when there's a problem, then everybody gets sued. So the recommendation here is make sure your geotech engineer has performed swell testing, and you geotech engineers need to perform swell testing below the deep basements, and also need to perform swell testing of the deeper soils for deep-seated swell that we talked about earlier. It needs to be identified, and then the risk is identified to the owner, and then they can determine what risk they want to take, if they want to extend the depth of moisture conditioning, if they want to accept the risk of deep-seated swell, if they want to use a structural floor to eliminate all risk. The owner needs to be advised so he understands his risks and can make the appropriate decision based on the use of his facility. Developer influence litigation. I better wind up here in a minute. This obviously is a big problem. These developers, whether they're residential developers or developing commercial buildings or some of these concessions for highway concessions for these design build projects where these freeways are being design build contracts by developers, the same problem happens every project. These developers are trying to influence the consultants. A lot of times they'll shop around for an engineer who will provide the recommendation he wants to for cost and time and cost. And they'll shop around, get the engineers that they want. They'll put pressure on the engineers to work with marginal factors of safety, do things that they really would not want to do, but are pressured to do that. And as a result, you have projects where you have multiple foundation failures of residential properties. We're not talking about a few. We're doing one where, you know, hundreds of homes are all being damaged from swelling and soils, improper subgrade preparation, improper foundation design. And then one of the biggest problems is these tollway projects where the owners are pressuring the engineers to cut back on MSC details, strap lengths, getting them, the engineers, to use slopes that are really too steep so that they don't have to use retaining walls due to limited right-of-way investigations, due to limited right-of-way limitations. And there's one project working on where it's a $500 million lawsuit because of settlement of approach slabs, settlement of concrete riprap over slopes around abutments, slope failures, retaining wall failures. All that had to be remediated, very costly, and it's a $500 million lawsuit by these concession owners. And, you know, they're, of course, they squeezed everybody to provide the recommendation they wanted, but and now they're suing everybody because it didn't work out. So you just better hold, you know, better know what you're doing. You better hold your guns and not allow these developers to influence you, because it's going to bite you. Well, that's about it for now. So I guess it's 10 minutes left for questions and answers. If anybody has any questions and answers, I can take those now.
There is one question, Mark. It says, on a site where the untreated PVI is 3 to 6 inches, the building is on piles. The stoops have zero PVI. The sidewalk was specified to have a PVI of 1 inch. The geotech called for over excavate 3 feet, then inject 8 feet deep lime slurry then backfill the 3 feet with select material. The heave is 3 inches next to the stoop. Do you think treatment was done?
No, it may have been done, but it wasn't done correctly. That's the problem with this injection stabilization. I used to do a lot of it back in the 70s and 80s. We used to try to inject everything back in those days because it was so economical, but we learned there's a lot of soil conditions where it doesn't work. It's not effective at all. And especially if you're doing chemical injection, the injector is having to pay for that chemical. And so he's going to whip along and go through the motions of doing the injection, but he's not doing anything. He's not getting anything accomplished. And so you end up getting a really, might as well not even have done it. And so it's not done correctly. And so to answer your question, it may have been done, but I doubt very seriously it was done correctly. I'd be very surprised if it was done correctly, because if it was, you wouldn't have the swell.
Are there any other questions? You can go to the Q&A and type them in. If you have any other questions. Otherwise, I want to thank Mark for his presentation today. It was there were a lot of very specific examples that gave us very clear understandings of the problem and solutions to those, solutions that hopefully are taken beforehand to avoid getting into litigation. I see there's some more questions here. The first one is, how should you run swell tests?
Well, swell tests are run with it's a little swell ring, same little test rings you use for consolidation tests, and you trim a sample into the swell rings. They're only about an inch long. You trim a sample into the swell rings. Now, different procedure is different than the consolidation, because when you're doing consolidation, you're testing moist soil that can be easily trimmed into a ring. But when you're testing dry, expansive clays, the clays are friable, they're crumbly, they're jointed, and when you insert the sample into the ring, you end up with voids around the ring. If you don't correct those voids, then your sample, when you're doing the swell, the sample will swell laterally and fill the voids, but you won't measure the volumetric swell. Maybe, for example, if you'd filled the voids, you might find you have a volumetric swell of 8% volumetric swell. If you don't correct those voids by filling the voids with your samples, trimmings of the sample before you start your test, you may only get a volumetric swell of 1 or 2%. And that's a big problem another problem with the geotechs underestimating the swell. They're not performing the swell test correctly. They're not filling the voids around the swell ring, and they're not measuring the vertical swell because of that void problem. It's a big problem. It's common.
Another question. What is the success failure rate? So either success or failure of the lawsuits that the speaker has been involved with. So what's your on that, Mark?
Well, we've been successful on all the ones that I consulted on. We came out very favorably in the lawsuit whether it be the defense of a client who is being sued frivolously, or a forensic investigation that we performed where a suit was brought on to others because of a problem. The attorneys tell me we've been successful in every one we've been involved in.
Okay, thank you. And then there's one more question. Can we get a copy of the presentation?
Yes, sir. You want me just to email that to you and you can distribute it?
Mike,
or do you want me to email everybody?
Mike, are you on?
Yes, Mark, if you just want to send that to me, I'll distribute it to all the attendees.
Okay, will do, Mike.
Thanks for that, Mark. There's another question. Is anyone developing a more reliable and realistic method of predicting PVR for buildings with sensitive materials or functions?
Well, there's a lot of research out there, and that's the problem, is there's a lot of information out there that's not reliable. You know, all these academics, you know, these research students and these engineers that are, you know, getting their advanced degrees, you know, they do these research projects and come up with these procedures that have no basis, basically void of logic and common sense, you know, and practicality. And it's literally some of these new methodologies, it's literally, you can't see the forest for the trees, you know, so I'm saying there's a lot of information out there, and that's one of the problems with the geotech engineers have. There's a lot of information out there that's bad information. And, but for swell testing, the only real reasonable way of determining swell PVR are swell tests, where you're actually testing the sample and its moisture content. You're determining the actual volumetric swell potential under its overburden pressure, and is extremely accurate in predicting the swell. I've compared my swell results on a number of forensic investigations where and construction sites, for example, where when we did water injection years ago, if I came up with a swell potential of 8 inches, you know, after injection, I asked the contractor to set grading stakes, and he's going to have to excavate and remove the swelling soil and to let me know what the swell was that he had to cut. And every time the amount of soil that heaved and had to be removed after injection was exactly what my PVR estimate was. And the same thing with forensic investigations. I've investigated buildings where the heaving occurred around the perimeter of a building due to poor drainage. And the amount of heave that occurred based on my swell, I ran swell tests on the interior of the building where it hadn't swelled. And the swell, predicted swell, was exactly the amount of swell that occurred. So I've done enough of these investigations to know the only accurate way to determine the swell value is to run swell tests, but they've got to be performed correctly.
All right. Well, thank you very much again, Mark. Appreciate your presentation and the good information that you've provided us. I also want to thank
all
the participants, and we will, you'll be getting the PDH information sent out to all of you who are on the call. And if you're at a group location, you can get the PDH credit distributed to the members of your group who were on the call with you. We are, of course, looking for others who would like to present a Texas section webinar. And if you would do that, you will get your, you can send information to Andre Salazar, that's asalazar@walterpmore.com. And we really appreciate that. The presentation will be made available by Mike to those who participated. So appreciate that, and we will